Local legend claims that these hills were split into three by an infamous wizard in the Middle Ages. Several hundred years later, they also inspired the imagination of author Sir Walter Scott. Find out which magical part of the UK I'm in just a moment. Today's house hunters are crossing the English Channel to start a new life after living abroad for 20 years. At first, we're in for a choppy ride.
Do you like it so far?
I like the feel of it.
Small.
Small?
But later, the outlook improves.
It's really nice.
Fantastic.
This is so pretty.
Today, I'm in the Scottish Borders, and these are the Eildon Hills, whose three separate peaks were forged by volcanic activity and not by a medieval wizard and monk. Now, the Eildons provide a wonderful walking terrain today, but evidence of settlers here is thought to date back to 7000 BC. Discoveries include flint tools, site remains of Celtic huts, and a Roman hill fort called Trimontium, which means three mountains. Now, undeniably, they are a dominant feature of the landscape, but also serve as a reminder of this region's rich heritage. The Scottish Borders is a council area with neighbours including Dumfries and Galloway and England to the south. From the rolling hills and moorland in the west to the gentle valleys and rocky Berwickshire coastline in the east, it's easy to see why Scotland's most famous writer and poet, Sir Walter Scott, chose to live in this region. The historic town of Selkirk in the heart of the Borders pays homage to this literary figure who also served as sheriff for 33 years. Rising above the River Tweed, the region's main waterway is the Leaderfoot Railway Viaduct. No longer in use, it's a powerful symbol of the region's industrial heritage, with textile production still prevalent in the area. The Scottish Borders has a coastline with the North Sea, and its dramatic sandstone cliffs are interrupted by pretty fishing villages like St. Abbs. Such serene countryside belies the region's turbulent past, fought over since Roman times. But these days, people head to the Borders for a peaceful way of life. Property prices in the Scottish Borders region have really fluctuated a lot over the past few years. Currently, the average price of a detached home here comes in at just over £230,000, which is £8,000 below the national figure for Scotland. Now, the new Borders Railway has really opened up the region, so that Edinburgh is only an hour away from towns such as Galashiels and Tweedbank, bringing families, commuters and visitors to the area. So it's going to be interesting to see what factors are driving today's buyers who want to move here.
Suli and her husband Chris are both lawyers. They first met when they were studying in London in the late 1980s.
We were both training to be barristers, and we met drinking at the bar, didn't we?
Suli didn't like me at all.
I didn't, actually, so I spent the next 2 years ignoring him.
Eventually, I asked you out. I can't remember when.
Did you?
Well, yeah, I did.
Oh, I don't remember that.
And the rest, as they say, is history.
Chris is a very nice man. Yeah, great person to be with.
Suli's a bundle of energy and warmth and life and keeps the whole place ticking over. We'd be very sticky in the mud without her.
Chris's work took the couple to Brussels, where they settled and had three children, who are now grown up. They've been in their five-bedroom house in the Belgian capital for nearly two decades.
We loved Brussels because it offers a real international mix. Unfortunately, because of the nature of Brussels, most of the people here are very transient. So every two or three years, people will move on and you have to make new friends. That's why I think we want to be part of a community where we can become integrated and contribute in some way too.
They've decided they want to return to the UK
and have earmarked the Scottish borders as a place to put down roots.
Both sides of my family can trace their roots back to Scotland, so I feel Scottish, and I identify with Scotland.
But I don't know Scotland anything like as well as Chris does. I'm being guided by him.
Their relocation isn't going to be the only major shift in their lives.
We'd like to move to a place where we can start running a bed and breakfast business, possibly, and also combine that with all our interests that we have.
My main interests are, on the one hand, music, and particularly I've always wanted to run a folk club. And on the other hand, I also like making things and mosaics and stained glass. I've just had a go at and really enjoyed.
And I enjoy pottery, I would like to be able to develop that further.
With their home in Brussels on the market, they're excited about the new adventure that lies ahead of them.
I would hope it's the huge change. I would like to go off and do stuff and be able to spend the rest of our lives doing these things we enjoy.
We're now at a stage where we've got the energy and the drive to do it. It's like starting in your life again, isn't it?
Chris and Suli have given us free rein to search the entire Borders region for properties. I'm meeting up with them in the town of Peebles to discuss the finer details of their wish list.
Well, Suli and Chris, welcome. A very warm welcome to the Scottish Borders. Hopefully, it's going to be your new home. So tell me, what exactly are you looking for in the property itself?
I would quite like a country home that has big rooms and high ceilings, and that has a lot of character to it. I would really love that.
Ideally, how many bedrooms? Because you've got three children, plus sort of partners and stuff that might want to come to stay with them.
That's the thing. But also, we're looking for the property to give us some form of income. So depending on how the property can be arranged, we would need, I think, six bedrooms.
How rural, ideally, do you want to be?
To be completely in the back of beyond and the middle of nowhere would not suit us so much. That would miss out on the community dimension of this move. So on the fringes of a town or a village where there is a real community would be an important part of our sort of wish list.
Let's clarify how much we've got to spend with this move.
£850,000.
Right. And that's your top marker?
Yes,
absolutely,
please.
The top.
Yeah.
And if we could spend a lot less than that, nobody would be happier than I would. I am Scottish, if you will.
We do have some properties, splendid properties, lined up to show you. Should we get started?
Yes, please. I can't wait, actually. I can't wait.
With a maximum budget of £850,000, Chris and Suli would prefer a period property that has an income potential. They'd like a total of six bedrooms spread across the main house or in outbuildings, so they can reserve some for bed and breakfast or self-catering guests. Location-wise, they'd prefer to be close to a village or a town with a strong community. We've cherry-picked three great country properties that meet their brief, but I won't be revealing the price until the end of each property tour. Our final option, the mystery house, will see how far they're willing to go for a slice of rural splendour.
It is going to be a huge change. This is the next big chapter in your lives,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yes, it is, actually.
Yeah.
It's a real new beginning. And it's a really exciting beginning. It's time for us, which is nice.
For our first property stop, we're travelling to Selkirk, at the centre of our search area. In centuries past, this attractive town has seen conflict due to its proximity to the Scottish-English border. Today, local residents benefit from a good selection of independent shops, and a mile outside of the town takes us to this superb listed Georgian farmhouse.
Right, our first property in the Scottish Borders.
Hello, home.
Yeah. Always a good start, isn't it?
I think the setting is lovely, and so the first impression is very good from that point of view, but we're going to have to see what there is behind the facade.
On that note, let's enter.
From this angle, this impressive house is deceptive. Built around 1760, with later additions in the 1820s and 1920s, there's a lot more here than meets the eye. The property was once home to celebrated Scottish artist John McNairn and provided much inspiration for his work. We're heading straight to the drawing room. Divided into two, one half is currently used as a music room and the other a formal sitting room.
So what vibe are you getting?
Small.
Small? Is it really compared to your other house?
Yes.
As in the sitting room or the overall space or...?
I think it's laid out differently. Whether it's small or is more sort of cosy, shall we say.
Yeah. Do you like it so far?
I like the feel of it.
I reserve judgment.
OK.
Although Suli is worried about the size of the drawing room, there is a further sitting room and a formal dining room on the ground floor. And there's also plenty of entertaining space in the kitchen diner.
So, I think, Suli, you know what I'm going to ask you first. Is this large, medium or small, in your opinion?
It's not a bad size.
No?
It's not a bad size. And I love the fireplace.
Now, how is that for a wood burner?
Absolutely.
Mm. Chris, tell me what you think of this kitchen.
I like it. I think it's a good shape.
It's nice that you have a door to lead out to the garden from the kitchen. That's really nice.
Definitely.
The ground floor has two separate stairways, one in the entrance hall and one by the utility just off the dining room. The character in this spacious home continues as we head to the first floor, where all the rooms lead off a generous central landing. There's a family bathroom with a feature bath and three bedrooms, including one double benefiting from an adjoining dressing room, and another with a decorative fireplace and a neighbouring bathroom. I'm taking Suli and Chris to the largest one on this floor, the main suite.
This is a nice room.
Nice room.
What's really nice about it is light. It's nice, it's got a very nice feel to it.
Yeah. Tranquil.
Yes. Yes, it is.
And you have, you know, views of the surrounding countryside.
Oh, wonderful.
This house, well, it's advertised as five bedrooms. In actual fact, it has six.
Right.
And they rent out two of the bedrooms, which have family bathrooms next to them, as B&B.
Brilliant.
Okay. You're looking at around £10,000 a year income.
Right.
That's not bad for two rooms.
For two rooms.
Exactly. Well, you know, there's plenty of bedrooms here, five or six at a squeeze. Let's head downstairs back outside and see what you make of the land.
Right.
Above us on the second floor are three bedrooms set in the eaves. There are two doubles accessed by the stairway in the oldest part of the house. And there's also the single B&B bedroom on the other side. As well as providing plenty of sleeping accommodation, outside is pretty special too in the way of land and outbuildings. There's a garage with an adjoining workshop, a storeroom with an art studio above it, a larger storeroom and an old horse mill known as a gin gang, currently used as a woodshed. But we're on our way to a gorgeous walled garden.
Now,
this is pretty.
Isn't it incredible?
It's
Come
gorgeous.
On in.
It's really nice.
Fantastic.
This is so pretty.
So you have this walled garden, but that's not all, because you've got about 2 acres of land, including all these mature trees all the way along, and then you've got a further 4 acres of pasture land, which is currently rented to one of the locals.
So
six acres in total, Really gorgeous.
No, I would feel very happy in here.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So now we're going to discuss the price. What are we thinking with our first property here in the Scottish Borders?
What would I say? I think it's below budget, but not a lot below budget. I would say £750,000.
No. No, no.
It's going to be £700,000.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah. She's so confident. Suli, you're so confident. They are asking for offers over, as we say in Scotland, £695,000.
What?
Yes.
I like it. So I think you should explore it.
Yes, please.
The outbuildings, the land.
And, well, I'll come and find you when you're ready. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Cheers.
This listed 18th-century property comes with a price tag, £155,000 under their budget. There's a large kitchen diner and striking Georgian features in its four reception rooms. The six bedrooms make it an ideal proposition for a B&B. The house sits in 6 acres of land, and although the location is rural, amenities are just 5 minutes away.
I really like this.
This is great, isn't it? It would make a great party room.
It is.
This is for you, is it?
Yes, I like this. I really, really like this. It has potential. The layout of the house, for me, is a bit quirky. I love the garden, absolutely love the garden.
It's a nice house. It's much bigger than it looks when you first arrive, because you just see one corner of it from the drive. And actually, there's a lot of space in it.
What we're trying to do is to find a lifestyle, and I think this house might just provide the lifestyle.
Well, that went well, didn't it? A few little hidden treasures during the house tour. And it's only our first property.
I know.
Is it going to get better?
I hope so.
Oh, good start.
On verra.
When they move to the Scottish borders, Suli and Chris are keen to play an active role in the community. Both love the natural beauty of the region, known for its sweeping valleys and dramatic mountains. The heritage of the nation is protected by the National Trust for Scotland, who rely on a committed band of volunteers braving all weathers to do their bit for the environment. We sent Chris and Suli to Greymare's Tail, one of the UK's highest waterfalls, where reserve manager Richard Clarkson and volunteer Bob McGoran are manning the fort, even on a day like this.
This is Bob, a visitor engagement.
Hi, nice to see you.
How are you?
Welcome.
Hello,
to the table.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to see you.
Greymare's Tail is one of 130-odd properties the National Trust for Scotland has. It's important for its upland habitats. Bob is a visitor engagement volunteer.
What made you join?
I had the available time was the first thing, but I did it 10, 12 years ago and then came back. This is my second stint, and I come back every week because I love it.
How many are there on the team?
Five, I think.
Five to kind of man this trailer, but then I've got some practical volunteers as well.
What practical work do you do?
Practical work is mountain footpath maintenance, so clearing cross drains. We've got fences to maintain, a little bit of tree planting. There's some biological monitoring as well.
Keen to get stuck into the tasks involved in maintaining the reserve, Suli and Chris are braving the elements to help Richard clear out some drainage channels. With thousands of people visiting Greymare's Tail each year, preserving the pathways is crucial.
So you can see we've got a problem here with the waters backing up. We've got lots of vegetation and debris stopping the flow of water away from the path. And what happens if we don't clear them is that it overspills a path and you get erosion. So periodically, 3 or 4 times a year, sometimes more, we have to clear all these cross drains to keep the water flowing off the path.
As well as clearing away the debris, Chris and Suli need to dig a new channel to allow the water to drain away from the path.
How did you get into this?
My passion was for wildlife, for the outdoors, for climbing mountains.
Right.
I went and studied, did a degree, and I was volunteering for the National Trust for Scotland, actually, and this was one of the places I was volunteering at.
Is that right?
And it was then lovely, eventually, to get the full-time role here as well, so it was quite very rewarding, and I love my job. You know, I love being out in places like this, even in weather like this.
Yeah, well, you look very happy.
It's hard not to smile when this is your office. The couple are finishing off their day by visiting the Greymare's Tail waterfall. Plunging 60 metres down into the Moffat Valley, the landscape has been created by glacial erosion over millions of years.
What do you think?
Wow! Look at that!
It's impressive.
What a reward, Richard. It was worth it. It was worth the climb, it was worth the rain. Fantastic.
That's what I like to hear.
Having learned how they could volunteer in their spare time, we still need to find Chris and Suli a permanent base in this stunning part of Scotland. For our next property, we're travelling to the hamlet of Nenthorn. 4 miles away is the market town of Kelso, whose smart buildings at its centre house a good range of amenities. It also has the largest cobbled market square in Scotland, overlooked by the town hall. Back in Nenthorn, we find our rather grand-looking second property.
So, I wonder what you're going to make of our next home.
It's got a nice entrance.
Nice.
Yeah. Yes, very quiet country lane.
Right.
Which I know is important. We don't want too much traffic at the end of the road. What do we think of the house itself?
It's got a nice frontage to it.
Well, we think it dates back to 1800s, 1850. That is the original part of the house. And it's a manse, the Scottish word, isn't it, for vicarage?
Vicarage, yeah.
Yeah, but it has been extended. I think you're going to love what's inside.
Oh, right.
Great.
This imposing house has a hall exterior, a weatherproof render traditionally used on Scottish masonry buildings. As we begin our tour, we're heading straight for the large sitting room at the back of the house.
You get a fantastic view of the garden, both sides, and the meadow.
Nice. It's a nice room. It's a nice room. And I'm not going to tell you it's small.
Are you not?
No.
Oh, Sully. We're becoming firm friends, aren't we?
Yeah, but this has a different feel to it, to be honest. I don't know, maybe it's the bay window.
It's higher ceiling as well.
Yes.
It gives you a greater sense of space.
Yes. Yes. You have this room, but you've also got one of a similar size next door. There's also a separate dining room as well next door, which, again, is of a good, generous size. I have a great feeling about this house. You're probably going to gather that as I take you round. I'm going to squeeze past you because next is the kitchen.
OK.
The kitchen is a Victorian extension on the other side of the property.
It's lovely. Yeah. It is nice.
Nice shape to it. It's not too thin and narrow. Nice light, too, coming from the windows.
Not too small.
Not too small, thank you. In addition to that, you have a walk-in pantry there with storage for clothes, etc., and you also have a downstairs shower room, stroke cloak room.
OK.
I think this is a superb, entertaining house.
Yes, Nikki.
Is that with enthusiasm?
No. I have to stop thinking like a lawyer and keep saying, we reserve judgment. OK. So, yes, Nikki.
OK.
Conviction.
That's good, is it?
Yes, yeah. Conviction.
Yeah, say it with feeling.
Yes. Say it with feeling. Yes. Say it with passion. Yeah.
Sully and Chris may be a little reticent in showing their feelings, but I think they like the house so far. Also located on the ground floor is a study and a large boot room with access to the outside. Then above us on the first floor are 5 bedrooms and 2 bathrooms. On one side of the house is a spacious dual aspect double bedroom, and behind is another double. On the other side of the house is a small double with an aspect to the front, and the smallest of the 5 is currently used as a snug. The 2 family bathrooms service all 5 bedrooms, including the extremely large and bright main bedroom. And with business opportunities in mind, I'm taking Sully and Chris outside. In a collection of outbuildings, there's a double garage, an office, a storeroom and a space that could make a perfect workshop. And above it all...
Now, this hasn't really been developed. At the moment, it's a kid's room. But I'm thinking either very nicely done B&B...
Right.
..or perhaps holiday lets.
And it's a nice room.
But you're seeing it in its rawest form, aren't you?
Yes.
Yeah.
But it has potential.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Still more to show you. Yeah.
OK.
Sitting in just over 7 acres, the land that comes with this property includes a 5.5-acre paddock, which could be leased out, a large barn, a chicken run, a vegetable plot, a small area of woodland, a raised seating area, and this beautiful lawned garden.
This property, can you afford it? Well, you were very good last time, so let's see how close you're going to get with this property.
745.
OK, £745,000. Right.
Pretty close to what I was going to say. I'll say 750,
OK. The asking price is... Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
Offers over... £695,000.
Oh, I was going to say it, then I thought, no, leave it, Sully. You can't say the same thing twice.
So why don't you have a private viewing on your own this time? Take a second look at the property and then give me a shout when you're ready.
OK.
Super, thank you.
This 19th century form of vicarage has come in way under budget and would leave Sully and Chris £155,000 to play with. Full of character with large rooms and high ceilings. There are 5 bedrooms and the sizeable outbuildings give scope for holiday lets. It all sits in over 7 acres of land and is just a few minutes' drive from a thriving community.
It's a nice big room.
It's nice.
It's a good sized room, all right.
Yeah. I like the entrance very much. I like the size of the house. I think it's got a really nice feeling to it. The sizes of the rooms are nice, the layout is nice. But I'm not sure what we would do with all this land, if I'm honest, because it's quite flat land.
This is a nice house, and one would certainly feel quite comfortable here. Certainly the main living area downstairs is... I could easily see myself sitting strumming the guitar in any of the rooms here.
I think I have found the perfect spot here. It's lovely, isn't it?
It's lovely.
Yeah.
So 2 houses here in the Scottish Borders, large properties, both under budget. That's not a bad day, is it?
Not bad at all. And look at the weather. Don't know how you did that.
Gorgeous.
Lovely day.
Let's hope it's this lovely tomorrow, because I've still got one more property to show you.
I'm really looking forward to that.
Yes.
Good.
Scotland with Chris and Sully, who want to escape city living in Brussels and move to the beautiful Scottish Borders. They have a budget of £850,000 to spend. Coming up, the setting of the mystery house delights our buyers.
The views here are probably the best views we've seen.
And I make a lasting impression at one of Scotland's oldest firms.
Once it's on, you can't move it, because if you move it, you'll smudge the tile.
OK. After living a life they've loved in Brussels, Chris and Sully now feel it's time for a change of pace with a move to the Scottish Borders. Yesterday, we showed them 2 houses that they liked, but I'm not sure were enough to entice them back to the UK. So today, with our mystery house, we're going to show them a real rural retreat complete with lake and fantastic views. Will this house be the answer? What's going to take you, Sully, out of your comfort zone?
Remote, rural, very rural. Now, I was hoping that maybe you're going to challenge Chris today and that you're going to find a house inside a village.
And if it is remote and rural, Chris is going to be rubbing his hands with glee.
Yeah. He is. But I tell you what,
not really,
he might be doing it on his own.
Our last stop to the mystery house takes us just outside the small village of Heriot, towards the north of the region. 6.5 miles away, a handful of amenities can be found in the rural village of Humby, surrounded by beautiful Scottish scenery. Despite being a quiet village, the locals are served by a shop, a cafe and a post office with access to broadband. Our rather remote mystery house is back in Heriot, but only 20 miles from Edinburgh. Now, it may be a little bit more off the beaten track than Chris and particularly Sully are expecting, but what it lacks in neighbouring community, it certainly makes up for in rural splendour.
It is a little damp today, but hopefully that won't put us off for our final property, which, is, of course, is the mystery house. OK.
Well, there's a surprise.
Always a surprise with the mystery. What's going through your mind, Chris? You inhaled a large amount of air. Surprise,
well, it's what or? I think is going through Sully's mind that is probably the biggest inhalation, in that it's very isolated.
I like the doorway. I like the arch very much.
And a wonderful aspect all around us with its own lake. It is rather damp. Shall we step inside?
Mm-hmm.
Although they seem anxious about the location, I'm hoping the remarkable house will deliver on the character they were after. With a unique layout in the shape of a W, it was built in 1935 by a local mill owner. We're starting our tour in the triangular hallway and heading for the main reception rooms.
The hall we've just walked through and this are clearly designed with to be interesting and have different shapes. And the views here are probably the best views we've seen.
It's very difficult to say anything about it until you see the rest of the house, because on its own, it's quite a nice room. It depends what other rooms are available, really.
Okay. All the rooms on this floor fan off the hallway and include another large sitting room, a study, and a cosy snug. We're heading across the hallway to the heart of the home.
It's a big kitchen, isn't it?
No. Oh.
No, it's a nice kitchen. It's not too small.
No, it's not really.
Moving on. Right, let's go next door.
A somewhat muted response so far, but this mystery house comes with a bonus feature downstairs, a ready-made option for their hospitality business.
So my quirky mystery house has an unusual layout downstairs, because we do have bedrooms upstairs, but this has a very large ensuite downstairs. But you've also got a downstairs cloakroom and a downstairs bathroom, which serves the other bedroom.
Right. It's great to have a bedroom downstairs.
Yes, that's true.
Above us, there's a long, bright galleried landing, which is really a room in itself and plays host to a further three bedrooms. There's a guest room with a feature window offering stunning views. It also comes with an ensuite shower room. The neighbouring room has a picture window, and on the other side of the landing is the final bedroom. The family bathroom features a roll-top bath. Having taken in the magnitude of the mystery property, it's time to explore the grounds and far-reaching outlook. There's a terrace lawn leading down from the house, and beyond that is a trout pond.
So not only have we shown you a rather large property here with a mystery house, but we also have the outbuildings to the side. So you've got a double garage, you've got a store, really, for your wood, but to the other side, you've got, at the moment, it's set up as like a workshop. If you wanted to, and you can seek planning permission on it, that could be converted into a holiday let building.
Right.
You've also got an additional 11 acres.
Oh, gosh.
It's quite a lot.
It is.
Well, you've done very well. You've done extremely well. And that's quite an attractive house from the outside. You can, you know, it's a nice shape. I'm not so sure about location for me, though.
That's what you're struggling with, isn't it? Because it is a beautiful home. We're going to try and put a price on our mystery house. OK, Chris, take it away.
Right.
Asking price?
I would go lower. I know there's a lot of land, but it's not a lot you can do with this land. So I would say 600.
OK. Sully?
650.
OK, well, the asking price, and it has only just gone on the market, literally in the last week, is offers over £575,000.
All right. OK. You were very close.
I won one.
You won one. Why don't you have a look at the project? Start off over there. I don't expect you to do the full 11 acres, but do enjoy the views. Take a look at that lovely lake behind us, and I'll meet you back at the house.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Our striking mystery house is priced a substantial £275,000 under budget, which would allow Sully and Chris the financial freedom to develop a fantastic business. The quirky home has large rooms, including five bedrooms, two of which are en suite. The home sits in over 11 acres of land. Its location may be remote, but it's only 5 miles from amenities and within striking distance of all that Edinburgh has to offer.
I was quite surprised by the house in that it's not a traditional house at all, and out in this location to find something, I know it's 1930s, but relatively modern, was quite a surprise.
The house itself actually has some nice features. They have a really nice gallery with a lot of light. There's a lot of wood paneling. But when I try and think about it in terms of business opportunity and in terms of living here, I really can't see myself settling down here. Not for me, really.
I'm going to bring you out into the elements. At least it's not raining now.
No.
It's dry.
And the sun's coming up.
Sun's coming up, blue sky. You see, I told you the weather's always lovely in Scotland, and that's it. We've shown you our three properties. We've had a range of reactions, haven't we? So I think you two need some time together.
Yes.
Gather your thoughts.
Yeah.
And the three of us will meet up and have a chat and find out what happens next.
All right. Thank you.
With all this beautiful countryside, it's perhaps hard to imagine that the Scottish Borders is home to an important part of the nation's industrial heritage. In the heart of the pretty town of Innalethan is a small business that dates back to Victorian times. Robert Smale's Printing Works still operates in much the same way as it did in the early 1900s. Property manager Rachel Mays is showing me around.
Now this, Rachel, is like stepping back in history. This is incredible, isn't it?
It's fantastic, isn't it? It's a great room.
What date would you put on this shop?
Well, this shop fitting that we've got here is from 1904, so the premises itself goes right back to 1866, but they spruced it up a bit in 1904, and that's what you're seeing in here just now.
What do we have in front of us? It looks extremely old and very delicate.
So this is 100-year-old copies of printing jobs that were done here on the premises. And what they had to do was, at the end of each day, glue a copy of all the different jobs into this book with a note of the number of copies and the date.
What an incredible record of what was going on in the local community.
Absolutely. It's an amazing social history record. It tells us not only about the businesses, but also the sort of community that was here. Things like the Operatic Society, the Silver Band, the Golf Club. All of these people would have had their jobs printed here.
Yeah, you mentioned the local golf club. This one, is this a bereavement card?
Yeah, so we've got the black border around it here, so that tells us it was a death notice.
So every day they had commissions?
Absolutely. Smales was one of the busiest places in town, right from... Every scope of society would have had to come here to get things printed.
Between 1866 right up until the 1980s, newspapers, business cards, stationery and letterheads all passed through the Victorian presses of this family-run business. Today it's in the care of the National Trust for Scotland, who have kept it going as a working printers. Tony Neopold runs the printing press.
How old is it?
This was brought in 1886, so what does that make that, about 130-odd years old? Yep.
And it hasn't moved since then?
No, it was put here then and has stayed there ever since.
My goodness. Looking at the condition of it, I mean, you can see it's had a working life, shall we say, but even to my eye, it looks in great condition. Is that a real testament to the workmanship when they were built, that they were built to last?
Well, yeah, they were definitely built to last. Probably over-engineered a little bit, I think, a bit like the fourth rail bridge.
So am I able to see the machine actually in action?
Yep, I can start it up and get it running for you.
Great, thank you.
This historic printer is a fully working Wharfdale-reliant letterpress. A rotating cylinder allows continuous printing, producing up to 1,400 copies an hour. Upstairs in the case room, Tony's shown me an earlier model, a Columbian Eagle press, which originated in America and works by pulling a lever down to produce a single page. He's already assembled the type or blocks of letters in a case. I just need to roll some ink over them before placing a blank bookmark face down on the type.
Once it's on, you can't move it, because if you move it, you'll smudge the type.
Okay.
Finally, some pressure is added to lock everything in place before winding the bed of the machine under the press. No chance of a paper jam here.
Pull the impression lever down.
This one?
Or across towards you, yep. Until it stops.
So all right, the eagle's moved.
Yep. Keep going.
Yep.
And just count to three.
One, two, three.
That's it, okay.
Release it.
Yep. Wind the bed back out.
Take this off carefully.
Lift the tin pin up.
Right, here we go. Have I created some printing magic?
Now, the idea is to lift it straight up so you're not dragging it across the type. And turn it around and have a look.
Well, a couple of smears, but that's not too
bad
at all.
Not bad for a first attempt.
Not bad at all.
150 years after it first opened, Robert Smale's Printing Works is still providing the town of Innerleithen with its printing and stationery needs, and long may it continue.
We're certainly in a beautiful part of Scotland with impressive houses, but have our overseas couple been sold on a new life here in the Scottish Borders? Let's find out. So we started this search hoping to find you your new home here in the Scottish Borders. I'm wondering how we've got on over the last few days. Have we got close?
I think you got closest with the first house, which had a lot of positives around it.
You love living in Brussels. I wonder, have we enticed you away to the Scottish Borders, Suli? Do you feel very at home here? Because in a way, it was a voyage of discovery for you, wasn't it?
It was. I think for me, what will make the difference is the ability to become part of something. I think the first property that was in Selkirk, because it's so close to the town, would tick that box.
Until you come here and see it physically in person, you don't get the sense of three dimensions, you don't get the feel of the place.
And so very true.
I feel as we move forwards, we're going to have to do a lot more travelling to come and find somewhere, because we simply won't be able to do it online.
Yeah. So I'm intrigued. What is your next move going to be?
Certainly a lot more research, a lot more driving around.
Our next move physically is to visit my brother up in Aberdeen, and we will probably go back to Brussels in a big loop by Aberdeen, Inverness and so on, so Suli can see more of Scotland and see what the other areas in Scotland look like.
So your aspirations for and with this move, they changed at all?
Not particularly.
No?
I think for me, I don't, having seen all these properties with so much land, I question whether we need so much land. I'd like to have enough land to have nice views, but I don't need acres and acres and acres of land.
Well, we wish you well with your continued
search.
Thank you. Obviously, we're sorry we didn't find you that perfect home, but enjoy your travels through Scotland. You're going to have a wonderful journey, I know, and let us know how you get on, won't you, in the future?
We will.
We will.
Thank you
thank
both
you.
Very much.
Thank Thanks. You very much. Thank you.
And thank you for your help.
Well, it's disappointing we didn't manage to find Chris and Suli the home or business of their dreams, but we wish them all the very best with their continued search here in Scotland. And I'll see you again soon on Escape to the Country.
If you would like to escape to the country in Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland or England and would like our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.